What is up, YouTube? Matt McKeever here, and today we're going to be talking about appraisals. So I know when it comes to appraisals, a lot of investors, especially new investors, have tons of questions around how do appraisals work, what are the different approaches, because there are different types of approaches. And today our local mortgage experts, Josh and Aaron from the Finlay Mortgage Team, are going to sit down with us and break down exactly what we can expect when it comes to appraisals. So where should we start?
Yeah, I mean, there's three basic appraisals that you're gonna see, different approaches. They all have their each specific uses. First one we'll take a look at is the cost approach. Pretty straightforward. They all pretty much are pretty straightforward. So the cost approach is basically just based on the relationship of the value and the cost of that building. So essentially in this one, the value of the property is actually derived from the cost of the improvement. And then that cost of improvement is added on to typically what the land value is. Some adjustments are going to be made, based off of whether it is how unique is the improvement made and the cost value of that unique improvement. And then based on averaging that out, the appraiser is going to come up with the value of that asset in that building. In this particular valuation, the land and the cost is actually evaluated separately. So you're going to have two different approaches, but then that's going to be blended together to give you your total cost of that asset. The appraiser is going to get the information in terms of the costs from a couple different resources. So he's going to go to like estimators or developers, third-party contracts, anybody who's really going to have a great sense of the cost to build and what those materials are going to be. This is typically used for valuing new improvements on a building. So if you've done some sort of like infill type construction where you've added something significant in terms of improvement value, you might use this type of valuation. Or if you're looking at a property that is quite unique and different and there aren't very many active sales or previous comparables to be able to derive a value from. So there isn't too many of these properties being sold, you're probably going to use a cost approach to come up with this sort of valuation.
I know when we're talking about the cost approach, I've also heard a lot of real estate investors, I guess, refer to it as the replacement approach, right? So kind of thinking of, what would it cost to replace this property or rebuild it or something to that effect, right? And I guess when we're looking at it through that lens, when you're thinking about some of your adjustments, we're probably adjusting for like age, condition, of those different improvements you were talking about, right?
Yeah, exactly. And the different materials being used to build, I mean, there's a difference between if it's concrete or, some sort of steel or wood. So yeah, the cost to replace, the cost to, or the cost to improve, it was going to be on a similar building if you were looking at an adjusted comparable. So yeah, you're really just looking at the cost, like you said, the cost of replacement for that improvement done. You may also see the replacement or the cost approach used in a income producing method, which is another approach that we're going to talk about, but in that type of method, when they're taking a look at some of the expenses and deferred maintenance, you may also see reference to the cost of repair or the cost of improvements.
Yeah, so the second comparison we're gonna look at, or the second approach we're gonna look at, is the most prevalent approach, which is the sale approach, or the sales comparison. Usually this is done with just normal residential real estate, a lot like, if you were to value your property, you're going to look at the direct comparable sales in your area. Say Betty down the street sold her house for $1 million. That's going to raise the value of your house as long as it's direct comparison because it's in the same geographical area. Now, most residential real estate appraisals are conducted through the sales approach or direct comparison approach, specifically because it gives them a defined cost or a defined value in a specific geographical area based off of a similar type of asset. What's going to happen is an appraiser is going to find four, maybe five direct comparisons, and what they're going to do is they're going to adjust the value of your property based off of the comparison of the four others that they've chosen, and it's either going to be a plus or a minus depending on a handful of different variables. Could be square footage, could be have a deck, a finished covered garage, different high-end finishes, location. It's a handful of variables that go into adjusting, either adding or subtracting value from a property based off the direct comparison approach. And most lenders use or weigh on this approach heavier than the other approaches for residential real estate, just because it gives them a more accurate valuation when it comes to a specific geographical area.
The third approach that we're going to talk about in the last approach is the income producing method. So this type of appraisal is usually typically seen when we're looking at investment type properties. This could be anything in that 3 to 4 unit property, depending on what the appraisal wants to, or the appraiser wants to consider it. So one thing to keep in mind is that these appraisal approaches are up to the appraiser. If they deem it is the appropriate approach to use, they will use that. Now, there could be some situations where I've seen it once or twice actually, where the lender actually disagrees with the way that the appraiser has used. So I think we had one happen where it was on a 3 or 4 unit, the appraiser used the income approach and the lender was like, no, we need to see this as a direct comparison. So just as a little like forward there, is it up to the appraiser and what approach? But being
quite often, yeah. some appraisers will use multiple approaches, yeah, on the same appraisal and then maybe weigh the two and compare them and outline why maybe one will be better than the other, and that kind of gives like a more accurate valuation, especially if the income approach is, the value is significantly higher than what the direct comparison approach is. If it makes more sense for the area and the type of asset to use direct comparison, they may weigh on that a little bit heavier.
Yeah, and it is commonly seen in the multifamily field as well too. You're gonna, on a full narrative report, which is what you're gonna have on a commercial, you're gonna have both a direct comparison and that income approach. And I find more often than not, it's weighted on the side of the income, maybe like 85% to 90% of that value. It's gonna be weighted towards that side.
And I know too, a lot of lenders may have certain stipulations like the lower of, right? So they might end up getting it priced according to all three of the metrics we laid out, but then they're directive or their decision is to use the lower of. And again, the idea there just being it helps mitigate some of the perceived risk, right? So if it came up with $1 million at, cost replacement, 800,000 at comp, and then 750 at the income-based approach, well, oftentimes the lender's going to want to lend at that 750 price, right?
Yeah, I actually just had a deal like that where the appraiser gave a value based off of the two ends of the cap. So I think they used a 5 and then a 7. So there was about 700,000 in difference between the two prices. And the one lender is like, no, I can only go based off the lower amount. And I was like, okay, I get it. But, so just keep those things in mind, where the appraiser is going to do what they want, but the lender is going to do what they want as well too. So, if you have any questions on appraisal, obviously just make sure you bring those up. But jumping back into the income approach, there's two methods that the income approach is going to use. There is the direct cap rate, and then there's a yield capitalization rate. So the direct capitalization rate is basically the relationship between 1 year's of net income, and then that value is then reflected through either a income multiplier or a capitalization rate of that specific market. The other method is the yield cap, and the yield cap takes a look at several years of stabilized income and a reversionary value that is often designated at the end of that period. And that comparison then provides a yield rate of income over that periodization of time. So the reason why there's two different types of methods is because, there's multiple ways to be able to actually determine the value, the income of these properties of these companies. And you're taking a look at either the net operating income, which is really more directed at that direct cap approach. And then there's your discounted cash flow method, which is a little more common when evaluating companies and stocks, not often as much on the properties, but it is a way to be able to determine the value. But predominantly, we're taking a look at a net operating income with a capitalization rate being used in the specific market to be able to determine the valuation of a property.
Yeah, and those DCFs are a lot more common when we're dealing with bigger buildings, right? And that's where kind of talking about it's dealt with more with companies. Well, oftentimes these bigger buildings essentially become a company in and of themselves, right?
Yeah, if you were maybe on like a REIT acquiring side, if you were looking for larger commercial type real estate, you're probably looking at the discounted cash flow method. But for the most part, with our standard investors in these medium to larger size residential, you're really just going to be looking at a direct income, net operating, and the capitalization rate in that given market.
Yeah, and I think understanding this approach is literally the golden goose of commercial financing. You know, people transition into commercial multifamily financing because it's so much easier to be able to increase the net operating income on an asset and force appreciate that value than it is to hope Betty down the street sold her house for a little bit more than what I did, and hopefully my direct comparison is going to bring it up a little bit. So having direct control over increasing the value of your property, this is how people do it. So if you're wondering why people get into multifamily, it's because we can multiply the cap rate by our total net operating income to get our actual value, and investors aren't investing in the asset because it's worth $1 million. They're investing in it because the revenue being generated on this asset is better than another building. So that's how we actually differentiate the value of these larger multifamily properties.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, really appreciate you guys breaking down for us just high level how this whole appraisal process works. Again, it's important that you guys at home understand it's a very subjective or professional judgment oriented sort of industry, business, profession, whatever we want to call it. So again, it's quite possible that one appraiser may walk into your building and evaluate it at this basis, and another one could walk in and evaluate at this basis. And understanding that there is some subjectivity here is key, because that also means sometimes it's a little bit malleable. And so understanding that and having someone on your power team that does, like Josh and Aaron, is really critical, because again, there's been times that appraisals haven't came in exactly where we expected it to come in at. Well, is there the option to get a second opinion? Is there an option for not to pick the lower of, but to pick the middle range of the three prices that maybe came in? This is where having that expert that regularly deals in this field with these types of buildings is so critical for you guys at home that are looking to start scaling up and really crushing it as real estate investors. Really appreciate Josh and Aaron.